We talked, we discussed in chambers before we started, procedurally, about a supplemental brief, by way of argument law, or whatever form, whatever length or brevity you wanted to make it, and in lieu of or in addition to argument here, and also a proposed order. Where do we stand now? Do you still want to make an argument here, Mr. Holmes?
I would request that, Judge, but I'm more interested in the court's focus of where you see any particular issue or whether it's you still want us to address everything. So I just think
I guess I'm inclined to leave it open to you because, I mean, I don't know the parties involved. I don't know the history of any issues. I don't know the particulars historically or very much currently of the finances of the county and all those kinds of things. And you're in a better position to know that than I am and to point that out if you think it's helpful to your case. I guess one of the things that in the argument today, it would be of interest to me is the, at least a quick summary of what you contend to be the legal standards we're operating under here. What's the burden of each party here? And I guess what's the limitations on what the court can do here? And with respect to what the county has failed to do that would support a mandamus order, and what is it they've not done that they should have done, or that the sheriff has asked for legitimately that they should have done and haven't done. I mean that's. It seems to me that's sort of the issue we're going to be looking at here to resolve about it.
I agree.
Okay. All right. You want a few minutes or take 10 minutes before we commence the arguments? Are you ready?
I'm ready. I was just going to conclude, Your Honor.
All right. Mr. Frey?
I'm ready to respond to anything he may say and certainly would still.
Well, he's got an opening and closing. I believe he's waving opening.
I will.
Okay.
I understand your points, Judge.
Your Honor, I think that
any address, anything you want to supplement.
I certainly would appreciate that opportunity to do that, and I'll keep it where you can stick to the points you just raised for this oral response here. The standard is, I'd say there are a couple of standards in operation here, several standards. The sheriff has, as he just said, the duty to carry out the statutory duties of his constitutional office, essentially to be the chief law enforcement officer of the county, and to do the things that he's done through the various divisions that have been represented in testimony here. He has those duties. County, on the other hand, has the duty to provide in a reasonable way a budget as best they can, as within the revenue that's available to them, that in an overall sense responds to his needs, even though, just like every other constitutional officer and other department, every other function, there may not be enough money to give him to do everything he would like to do or to do it in the way he feels like would be best. I don't think that there's a burden on the county legally to give something to him just because he comes to them with a request or something that's not off the wall. Frankly, I think that what you have heard is probably pretty typical of the kind of requests and justifications that were made across the board by the various departments and agencies and officials. They were not outlandish in any way. The county would like to no doubt have done more, but they were constrained by the available revenue. The burden is on them to act reasonably in the way they make the decisions about how to assign that available revenue. And the standard is quite simply abuse of that discretion. They have the discretion to set the budget. He does have discretion to move money around within his available budget that has been provided to him. And he's aware of that. He's exercised that discretion and that authority in this past year. But that said, he does not have the discretion to set his own budget. That burden is on the county, that responsibility, and ultimately they are stewards of the funds that the public entrust to them, in the sense of not only what's in the bank, but in the approach they take to finding revenue sources and to determining things such as millage rate. They can't determine how much money comes in from loss or splost. They can make projections, and they've given you an idea of how they've made those projections. But they have to balance out the available revenues with those legitimate needs across the board. The sheriff is just one moving piece, albeit the biggest piece, the greatest piece, and I would submit has been given due regard by the commission in meeting their burden of providing funding to him in response to his request. They have given priority to public safety, more so to the sheriff's office than to the fire, EMS, and EMA public safety departments. But collectively, that's nearly half of their budget, and the sheriff has the biggest part of it. So it shows the emphasis that they put on the sheriff, his function, his duties, and his requests. I think they've acted entirely in good faith. I think it's obvious that they've been very diligent in their approach to this year's budget and have made an effort to be thorough. They have tried to gather as much information as they could. They've tried to involve departments, officials, and agencies in as much input, including appearances before the board in a greater degree of transparency, in a greater degree of participation and involvement across the board, and even in the form of an earlier start, as described. So I think that there's certainly no reason to think there's been an abuse of discretion, certainly nothing that would be a basis for mandamus in the sense of an order to give more money to the sheriff for 2018. They will certainly be, as they have said, revisiting during the course of the year what to do in terms of possibly amending the 2018 budget. And given where we are in the year, it won't be long before they will already be working with him towards trying to develop a 2019 budget. That process will be starting soon. I think that mandamus is only available in the case of a clear legal right And I don't think he's shown any clear legal right to anything more than what they have given him. The difficult aspect of this is if you were to try to fashion a remedy here, the courts are limited in what they can do. Obviously, the courts are not in a position to police line items of budget allocations and appropriations. And the case law, I think Mr. Homans would agree, does not put that burden on you. So the most that would be doing would be done with a mandamus in any event would be something that they are already going to be doing in the revisiting of the budget during the course of this year for 2018. But as I say, already looking forward to the prospect of working with him towards the fiscal year 2019 budget that's coming up. I think the basic need for it, the basic way to approach fashioning an order or remedy in terms of mandamus, not only is it unnecessary and unjustified, I think it would be a very difficult thing to put it into terms that could be employed by these parties short of what they're going to be doing anyway. With that, I'll leave it to Mr. Holmes. Thank you, sir.
Judge, as to your question, the burden of proof is a civil case. It's by preponderance of the evidence, and what we have to establish is whether the sheriff has shown here a legal right to the relief sought, which is the mandamus, to require adequate funding of the sheriff's office to permit the sheriff to perform his duties of enforcing the law and preserving the peace. What needs to be understood here is that the sheriff is an elected constitutional officer. And so under the process, under the Saber decision and what we put in the trial brief, is that he is to submit a budget that he says is necessary for him to perform his duties. The law does grant the commission, the county commission, the authority to cut that budget. But in the course of making those cuts, the sheriff still must be permitted to enforce the law and preserve the peace. And so as to the abuse of discretion standard arises as to whether the Board of Commissioners abused their discretion in the cuts they made to the budget he proposed, that is the sheriff proposed, that still permit him to perform his constitutional and statutory obligations. So I understand how the county's going about that, but I submit it misses the mark because the county's saying, well, here's where they were in the past. But as to a reason for cutting the budget proposed by the sheriff, they've really not presented any evidence. And for that reason, other than they say we don't have sufficient revenue, and that we come back to, that's what we would say in the writ, or that the writ would be ordered by the court, is that Board of Commissioners, I'm entering this writ of mandamus requiring you to adequately fund the sheriff's office, is in essence what it would be. It's not your determination as to what that adequate funding is. The law clearly makes that a legislative function, so it would go back to the Board of Commissioners. That's the focus of most of the cases. We went into some of the detail that we went into during this trial because the standard is abuse of discretion. So the abuse of discretion is not adequately funding, but we took it one step further, Judge, or actually maybe several steps further. And as we've shown here, the commission not only abused their discretion by not adequately funding, but they didn't even adequately present their options. I want to say to Chairman Thurmond that the sheriff and his staff and I couldn't appreciate more him being here. But I think it ought to speak volumes that no other commissioner even sat through to hear what it is that is the concern for the sheriff's obligation to enforce the law and preserve the peace. When you heard those witnesses, it's not a question of if something terrible is going to occur in Dawson County, because our sheriff's department is not adequately staffed. It's a question of when. We've had a couple of incidents where our deputies have been injured. It's going to continue to happen. And that's what these deputies came in here and told you. We're really 22 people short, we're now 26 people short. And the sheriff, out of all good faith, came in with this budget and said, okay, if you will give me the 10 positions that I seek, then we'll keep working toward the 139 that Mr. Hallsworth says he needs. And if you heard the testimony of the officers, the captains and the lieutenant who was here and the sheriff, that's really what they need. But we had added three through the 17 budget, and as long as we see some progress toward filling this void to 2015 and given the growth, the explosive growth, particularly on the commercial retail that was testified to by Ms. Nyker, that's drawing in a whole population, or a whole lot of population other than a residential population, that puts the burden on the sheriff's office. I agree with what the chairman's saying. Who's that going to impact? Planning. And it's an abuse of discretion, because they gave, what we're trying to show is you meet those needs, commissioners, you give them two people in 17. You get nine to the fire department, they're going to be impacted by this type of growth. But to say to the sheriff's office, you stay the same. And they came in saying that we didn't add patrol was one of the public statements that was made. That's not what you asked for. And that just wasn't true. That's the abuse of discretion. Is nobody went to the sheriff and said, well, what are these positions? What do we need? And had that been done, then they would see that there are needs here. Is he willing to work with them? Yes. In fact, that's why we tried to propose solutions. That's why my letters are there. Everybody says you have more options with capital than you do with people. All right, we'll live with that. We'll live with that. We understand your limits that you have, because you only have so much revenue. We understand. So let's go to the capital project side of that, and let's work together to find a way to fund these capital projects in a way that won't exhaust an entire amount. That $260,000 is why I kept coming back to it. With these critical needs, why would you take that money and just set it on the sideline? That would fund two, three, or more, several positions for the sheriff's office, and we can start working together. If you'll unfreeze these positions, or some of them, then we can move forward, but they won't. And that's the abuse of discretion, is not understanding their options. We know they didn't understand their options, because even the information they reported stated that they gave him a more, an increased budget that he doesn't have, and said he had control over the SPLOST money that we know he doesn't have control over. That's set by the voters, and we'll work with it. I don't see that it is a stretch under the SPLOST law, Your Honor, and I'll just put it in my brief rather than standing here talking to you about it. But it's a clear SPLOST item. If you've got a sheriff's vehicle and equipment and a fire truck and equipment, how in the world CAD can't be considered part of that equipment is unknown. And the abuse of discretion is to come in here and say, well, we raised your SPLOS budget for the year, when under the SPLOS, he should be getting $600,000 a year if you're going to do it that way. And really, the SPLOS money is going to come in more than the $46 million. We ought to recalculate that SPLOS. We're willing to work with them, however. That's the abuse of discretion, is to say, I said no, and therefore it's no. And instead of meeting with us, commissioners got together in private and modified this budget and marshaled it forward. But for us, we go to a public meeting and get asked about eight-month-old contracts that have already been paid. So it doesn't appear that there's any willingness to have dialogue. There wasn't any dialogue in those meetings. We came there to hear speeches. The option of saying you've got an entire salary amount. That's something that the county's hinted at. Okay, you've got an overall budget. So if you want more people, then you just hire those people with the overall budget. What does that mean, Judge? That means they want them to go into the sheriff's office and say, okay, everybody's got to take a salary cut so that we can fund these other positions. You know what we're going to have then? We're going to have a drop in the number of people that are within the sheriff's office, and we're going to be in a more drastic and dire need than as we stand here today. We submit that the evidence here shows the abuse of discretion by not properly funding the sheriff's office. But more than that, we show it's abuse of discretion because they refused the Board of Commissioners as a whole, not the chairman, but the Board of Commissioners as a whole absolutely refused to consider viable options to meet the needs of the sheriff's office, or at least start meeting the needs of the sheriff's department, so that he can do his job that he was elected to do, to enforce the law, preserve the peace, and prevent a tragedy from occurring. Thank you.
Well, let me say, first off, I think it was a well-tried case on both sides. And let me also say, I think Dawson County is fortunate to have elected officials that we've got here with the sheriff and the chairman. Obviously, both bright and competent and don't mind working, which is not always the case of public officials. So I think Dawson County is fortunate. And the issues here, obviously, they're serious issues, but I think anybody can recognize. You don't have to be a lawyer, a judge, or an elected official of any kind. Look at the instances and importance, I guess, of the kind of people you got, being able to pay them a decent pay is, I mean, given the times we live in, politically and societal, I guess, the prospects of having a deputy stop a car in the middle of the night on a back road somewhere, not having a clue who's going to come out, whether they're going to have a weapon or not, or what kind of problems you got, what kind of threats you got. I mean, that's kind of, I guess, these days routine stuff in police work, unfortunately. And things like the being able to provide sufficient courtroom security is, everybody knows, I suspect, about folks in the county's experience with a judge and court reporter shot dead in the courtroom, a deputy shot dead in the courthouse, and a federal agent shot dead thereafter. I mean, those are things that happen. And the less competent people you've got, the less security you've got, the more likely those kind of things happen, which doesn't make anybody happy. So, and on the other hand, I think obviously you got county commissioners elected to run the county government. That includes paying attention to how you spend the money and do it. You spend it in public funds, and it's not something that's not a frivolous kind of action. The proposed budgets and authorized expenditures, and is an obligation obviously to look critically at proposed budgets of department heads and all that sort of thing. It goes with it. They're not doing a job if they don't. So I think those are issues, and I don't find, and it doesn't appear to me as capricious or arbitrary kind of acts either way, but the question is, based on the evidence to apply the law here, what's the result? And that, I don't know at this point. I'm going to sit down and take a look, review the evidence. I'll take a look at the supplement you submit, and see what appears to be, in my judgment, the appropriate order in doing that. And let me just say one other thing that I don't know to what extent there have been efforts to resolve the case, but it seems to me there ought to be a face-to-face, sincere sit-down here between the parties to see if there's some middle ground here. And I don't know if there is or not, but it seems to me this kind of case might very well find some middle ground. I mean, obviously the county's not loaded up with excess money to grant every authorized expenditures, whatever anybody wants, including the sheriff. On the other hand, we've got people who've got obvious needs that are important to the community, then that's something that ought to be addressed, give consideration as well. But it's some of the considerations seem to me is no matter what the order is, it comes out of this case by way of the trial. You've got a good likelihood, I suppose, that there'll be an appeal by the person who the party that doesn't get what it wants. In which case, it's another delay and more attorney's fees and time that comes with an appeal. And maybe it's not resolved before the next budget's addressed and got the same issue continuing on into the next budget. So it's just all, it seems to me, some time-wise, money-wise, and general ability to function-wise for the county and for the sheriff's department sitting down and taking a look at reaching some kind of accommodation to each other, and maybe some middle ground to resolve this and put it to rest and go forward. And I don't know if they can do that or not. I guess lawyers always ready to say, okay, you want an appeal? You want another round of it? Here's my fee. I need some money. And that goes with it, and as far as it wouldn't do it, then the courts are there, and we've all seen cases that go on and up and down and cut courts and all that sort of thing. Don't seem to be in. It seems to me with the parties that we've got here and the competence of the parties here, that the experience of the parties here, that there ought to be some middle ground to find something that fundamentally works. May not make everybody totally happy, but can fundamentally work. You know what the budgets are, you know what the needs are, and all those kinds of things. So that'd be a matter of you sitting down and deciding if you can. And if you can't, then I'll do my job, which is to draft an order, assign an order, whatever I deem appropriate. And at that point, we have unhappy folks. Then the appellate courts await. Anything else from the petitioner?
Judge, just a timeline. What kind of timeline?
What do you want?
A week, 10 days, something like that.
Mr. Pryor?
I'd say 10 days, particularly if we're going to be able to follow up on your suggestion that you just made. I think that we can be diligent about both.
That's mad at me. Whatever works for you, tell me what it is.
10 days.
10 days.
All right. 10 days, well.
That'll probably fall on the weekend. We lose track of time in here.
All right, so what does 10 days come to? Where is that?
It'll be Saturday.
Up the calendar.
10 business days.
10 business days.
All right, so that's two for the rest of this week. That is 7, 8, 9, 10. Close of business Thursday, February the 15th. How about that?
Yes,
sir. Honor before February 15th. Is that satisfactory?
Yes, sir. We'll just explain that while we're working on Valentine's Day.
Don't put it out, dude.
Okay.
We stand adjourned.
Thank you.
Court is going to have the exhibits. It's good to see everybody here. You got to give your folks here all the way around. We're good to meet you.